not even 3 o'clock. And here I am at the ballpark. The Somerset Patriots were rained out yesterday, so tonight's a twin bill.
Hey, that's a nice piece right there.
Sure,
yeah, I've 8 other guys wondering what the heck's going on right now. He's a great guy. Terrible swing. That's a really bad swing. Good guy, though.
It's kind of atrocious at the beginning.
On a scale of 1 to 10, about 1.5, maybe 2.
Let's try it. Use it tonight.
All right, I'll use it again. Doesn't work. If I don't get any hits, it's your fault. No, he's got the most expensive bats, and they just don't work. You know, can't buy a swing.
He didn't make the Pop Warner League, so they started a different league for the kids that didn't make the Pop Warner League. They had a dinner at the end of the year, and they gave me an award for the Mother of the Year because I never went to any baseball games.
So now you know, baseball was never really a career choice for me. I was so bad, even my mother knew it. But I can't doubt myself. I have to try to do this.
So anyway, I got a lot of work to do, but my dream is to come and play for you next year.
It's taking too big of a stride.
I'm a musician by trade. I started a band called the Smithereens, and we hit it big about 20 years ago. Gold records, top 10 hits, sold out concerts, the whole shebang. Mom was happy.
I was in my office and about 5 phone calls came up and said, your son's on the radio with Blood and Roses. It was really a big thrill.
Programs, scorecards.
Stay with me, stalwart viewer. And be assured our story will not be a retelling of my notorious musical heights. However fascinating my mother would find that story. No, our tale is about baseball, music, friends, and legends.
He's out of there.
And the curious saga of my most improbable journey. And how I wound up at this ballpark on a warm, muggy, drizzly June night.
Hey, DiNizio, come on over here.
You've been working so hard, made a lot of improvement. So tonight you're gonna get your shot to play. Don't let us down, because I'm sticking my neck out here for you.
No, I know that.
So you're gonna play tonight.
Come on.
I'll give you the nod, but you're gonna play.
You're kidding, right?
No, I'm not kidding. This is real, man. Okay, you ready? Are you ready?
You really want me to play?
I want you to play. Okay. Go suit up.
You got it.
All right.
I won't let you down.
I know you won't. Better not.
Let's face it, this is the moment I've been working towards for over a year. And trust me, as surprised as you are to see me here, it's even more amazing for me. It wasn't so long ago that I was stricken by illness. I was so sick I could barely get off the couch.
Had to take him to the hospital. Not once, maybe 2 or 3 times.
It was an allergic reaction, and sometimes the pain was so bad I couldn't move my arms or legs. It even hurt when I tried to talk.
Not only did he have it on his arms, on his face, all over his neck. It's nothing funny. You can really die from it.
But even at my lowest point, I still had baseball. Somehow those games kept me sane. I began by zeroing in on the hitters, and soon I was thinking right along with them. Then, it was like a song coming out of nowhere. This dream emerged. As my health improved, so did my capacity to imagine. First off, new priorities. Never mind the driveway. Give me a batting cage. I've convinced some of my friends of the importance of this apparatus. It was basic to mission. They were kind enough to show up with picks, shovels, and some heavy equipment.
Pat, did you see Rick Springfield at the show in Virginia?
I saw myself as more of the foreman of this job, supervising the work. I was the hitter, and they were my ground crew. To tell you the truth, work never came easy to me.
My husband and I were in a disposal business, and it was tough getting him up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I told him I would have liked him to be a lawyer. That's, in fact, what I wanted him to be. And I said to him very politely, when are you gonna get a job? And he says, I'm gonna do music, don't you understand?
My journey begins with a stop at the home of a fellow New Jersey rocker, the boss himself, who played some baseball before sending the world his greetings from Asbury Park.
I was good off the field. I was good in the parking lot. I was a good player in the parking lot and in the sand lot, but the minute I got the uniform on and on the field, I don't know, something happened. I'm not sure why.
Bruce and I met in a Hollywood recording studio back in 91. We were both making albums. We hit it off.
I played everything that season. I played third base, which I used to love to play. I played a little bit of shortstop.
Soon we were sharing our Jersey roots, our love of music, memories of the same places. Freehold, Long Beach Island, Belmar, and oh yeah, those trips to Yankee Stadium. Our heroes were Maris and Mantle, the M&M boys. The summer of 61 was like a great movie that never ended.
I remember following Maris chasing their home run record that year, like home run by home run. I can remember counting them off, you know? It was just, I was 11.
Bruce's song, Glory Days, has been running like a loop in my head lately. I saw myself on the fields of my youth. It was beautiful.
The first verse is about baseball, and it came out of an actual incident. I met a school friend. I was walking into a bar one afternoon, and he was walking out, and hadn't seen each other since probably high school. And he was on this team I was on in Babe Ruth League, the Braves. We were the Braves. And bumped into one another and said, hey, let's go back inside and have a drink. And that whole first verse, word for word, sort of happened, you know? So I played baseball from when I was 6 to when I was 15, to the year that I picked the guitar up. But I was always bad. I was always terrible. The exception of I had one good season, I think it was I was 12. It was opening day, and I got up, and I hit a double. And I was terrific the rest of the year. But the breakthrough only lasted for me 1 year because I did so well that they brought me up to Babe Ruth League, and there were guys that could throw real curves.
We grew up about 35 miles apart. Bruce is a little older, but our stories sound the same. I played Little League too. Then just like Bruce, I picked up a guitar and my world changed.
I remember I got up at the plate and Lance Rowe was pitching. Lance, I know you're out there somewhere. And Lance fires one straight at me, and I leap back, which then, of course, immediately curves across the plate. Strike! And I resorted to my terrible ways.
Over to first. He's out of there.
The next year, Bruce bought his first guitar for $18. Good investment. Coming up on seventh inning stretch.
I was desperate to find something that I could do.
Bruce Springsteen makes a fateful decision.
They're looking for you to play. Hold on, tell them I'm sick. You know.
Ready, scared of shit out of me. I'll say anything you want to.
And later,
even though he's 49 years old,
we check in with Mom for an unbiased opinion.
I'm sure he's gonna make it. I know he'll make it. Is that it?
Those clouds look like they could open up at any time. Hey, a rainout could be a good thing, at least for one insane individual named Pat DiNizio. What am I doing here? What if I get the call from Sparky? I'm getting way too edgy. Think of simple things, happy times, like hanging out with Bruce Springsteen in his backyard.
So who are your other victims? I mean guests on the...
I had the classic sort of clash of my two passions was the last year in Babe Ruth League. I was kind of showing up at the games, but my heart wasn't in it. I was starting to play the guitar.
Maybe if you had been really good in baseball, you wouldn't have picked up the guitar.
It could have been, because low self-esteem is essential for all rock musicians. You cannot make good rock music without being desperate, you know? By the time I picked the guitar up, I was desperate to find something that I could do.
He was not yet 16, and Bruce was already playing in local clubs on Friday nights, then showing up for baseball on Saturday mornings. It was definitely a conflict of gigs.
I gotta make my first big decision, and I decide, screw it, I'm not getting up the next morning. So next morning, I'm tucked in my little bed, and I hear banging at the door. My mother comes up and says, "Other, they're looking for you to play." Mom, tell them I'm sick, you know. Tell them I can't play. She goes down, she comes back. No, they only have 8. If you don't show up, they're gonna forfeit the game, right? So now, so I drag myself out of bed. I get the uniform on. It's 10 in the morning, I get over there, and I'm out in right field. I think I'm just about through. This is my swan song for my career. And bang, somebody hits something. Big pop-up right out in my direction. I'm circling underneath it. It kind of just glances off my glove, cracks me in the skull.
No.
Yeah. And I drop. Bang. And all I hear is, "Throw it in! Throw it in, man! Throw it in!"
Bruce told me he hadn't thrown the ball around since that day, and that he thoroughly enjoyed the diversion. We shared a snack, and I thanked him for his hospitality, and I told him that I looked forward to the next time our paths crossed. Back home, I kept to my ritual of batting practice in the driveway, followed by more batting practice.
What speed is that, you know?
About 90. Bat in front of it.
I kept telling myself, little steps, Pat, little steps. It all began for me in the summer of 64. My face was pressed against the glass in the back seat of our station wagon. And there, appearing just ahead, were those big blue letters that spelled the answer to a dream, Yankee Stadium. 40 years later, I'm that same kid, not only feeling, but living and extending that dream.
So many kids, they seem to put the bat like back in here.
You know? When I started, I was like that.
They want to squash it.
After much pleading, not to mention weeping and wailing on my part, Don Mattingly agreed to analyze my swing.
Since I haven't really seen you play,
yeah,
I'm just going to kind of let you stand in here, just kind of watch you. Just go ahead and swing, you know. 10 or 12 to start getting loose and just kind of see what we're working with. All right. You ever swing an axe?
Yeah.
That's the baseball swing.
The level swing?
So you're swinging the axe like, I'm going to hit that tree right there. I'm going to swing it like I'm gonna wind up here, and I'm gonna try to come down in this. Now look at my bat.
Okay, so he's swinging down, but you're leveling it out.
You're leveling it out.
Mattingly bobs one high, deep to right field. Tattleton to the wall, it's gone!
Like Derek Jeter today, Donnie Baseball was in his era the quintessential Yankee. He was a study in understated grace and power, and his swing was to die for.
That's a problem with me, because I'm swinging.
You're basically going right here, I see right now, and then you're doing this. So if I go from here, A, B. So the same thing, I just want you to hit the ball right back at me. Everything's designed to hit the ball back at me.
Don wants me to hit down on the ball and shorten my swing.
There you go, right there.
He improves my balance by having me practice with 1 foot off the ground before the ball arrives, which is even harder than it looks.
Because hitting's kind of a little bit of like a bow and arrow. If I'm going to pull a bow and arrow back and I'm going to shoot it, I'm not going to go real quick. And that's what happens with a lot of guys is we end up saying, okay, wait, you got to be short, you got to be quick. This guy's throwing 95, he's got a split, he's got all this stuff. Mm-hmm. So you know, you want to wait, and we kind of end up doing that instead of saying, okay, here it comes. All right, one for one.
A few years ago, George Steinbrenner sold Donnie on the idea of becoming the Yankees batting instructor. It's been a happy match, the boss and the guru. Talk about looking good. I think Donnie could still win the batting title. Then there's his student.
Just in case you don't hit, you look good. That's what it's all about. You have the right wristbands, you have a good looking bat. So if you don't hit, you're gonna be looking good.
That's the whole thing, right? How about his age? He's 49. Too old?
49. He could be past major league prime, but just barely.
Thanks.
Coming up on Seventh Inning Stretch.
The advice I'd give you, find ways to get in and out of the hotel after curfew.
This is my home room over here.
And later,
I mean, I never learned how to throw properly.
Be really careful.
That right there is his best swing of the day right there.
When you're hitting a baseball bat, you got that much room to be good.
Should I go all the way to the mound, or should I just go halfway and underhanded?
My Midwest swing of club dates started in Chicago. So I took in the action at one of the game's cathedrals, Wrigley Field, hoping I might find some sort of answer to my prayers, or maybe just some helpful advice. This dream, I'm trying to play minor league ball at age 49.
Yeah.
What do you think? You think I'm nuts?
Well, no, I don't think so. You know what? I tried to do it when I was 60. I went to Japan. I figured they never saw me. So I dyed my hair and went over there, and it didn't take but a day or two. They found out, and, you know, I had a bad time with that. The advice I'd give you, find ways to get in and out of the hotel after curfew. Do that, because obviously playing is easy, but you know, if you want to stay out after curfew, you got to find a way in and out of the hotel. You got to know which bellmen aren't going to squeal on you. You gonna have a limo driver?
My own.
Yeah.
I got to pay for it though.
Oh, you got to pay for it?
Yes.
See, if I was you, that's the first thing I'd ask for, you know?
I decided not to tell Euchre that Sparky, Lyle, and I had hardly discussed a limo. Next stop, a gig in Iowa. When in Iowa, you go to the Field of Dreams. They maintained the field as though Kevin Costner were coming back tomorrow and Shoeless Joe still lived in the cornfields. Who knows? Maybe he does. Let me tell you, there's something about hitting a ball into a cornfield that is very satisfying.
I used to travel in the shadows and I never felt the need to try to walk to you.
It's almost a straight shot from here, due east to Milwaukee, where the Brewers were looking for a backup catcher. baseball is not all about hitting. That's why I'm here with Coach Rich Donnelly.
Show you now how to block a pitch, the proper procedure in blocking a pitch.
Put your hand behind your glove, lay your glove on the ground, close up the hole, and the idea is to have the ball hit there or there.
Catch the ball and drop to your knees and block the plate. Hit it and get out of there. Get out of there. That's it. Get it out. Tag me. Out. Good.
Okay. So at least I left enough time for a quick guitar lesson for a curious brewer. I'm back in Jersey for a visit to my old high school. I have stolen away from our festival gig with Joan Jett.
This is my home room over here. I'm just trying to go back in time.
Joan is a true original, a real baseball fan, and a true friend.
My dad took me to see the Orioles play the Oakland A's, who I believe it was Jim Palmer pitching against Catfish Hunter.
Oh.
And it was a no-hitter. Jim Palmer threw a no-hitter. So that was the first game I ever saw live in Memorial Stadium, about 10 rows behind home plate. So from that moment on, I was addicted. She got
smoke, but they call her a punk. 25 years ago, record companies wouldn't touch Joan Jett. So she created her own label and sold records out of the trunk of her car. 2 years later, her single, I Love Rock and Roll, topped the charts for 8 straight weeks.
I was a real jock, but you know, my high school, we didn't have any school teams for the girls. We had no soccer, no softball, none of that. So it was mostly just street ball. I did go to a fantasy camp, and there were 105 people, 5 other women besides myself. And I started out at second base, and then I did some pitching and proceeded to rip my shoulder. Because, you know, I was so enthusiastic, and I think everybody was amused, so they just let me do, you know, whatever I was doing.
I never learned how to throw properly. So I have to relearn how to throw.
Be really careful. I was trying to throw so hard that I was just letting go, but nobody was saying, Joan, you're doing this for 2 weeks. Take it easy.
I'm taking Joan Jett's warning to heart. Because, to be honest, this whole adventure has taken its toll.
He was always thin, thin as a rail. In fact, I used to say to him, eat. But I think when he gets anxiety-like, and he wants to eat, don't we all?
I was the skinniest kid in the neighborhood.
Just bring the piano down just a little bit.
But when the doctors prescribed something that helped clear up my condition, my weight increased to the point where now it's a daily struggle to keep it down.
We just live in.
For some advice on weight and age control, I went to the man. Julio Franco, at 47, is the oldest active player in the majors.
I'm trying to get my health back, and I'm trying to get it back through baseball, and I want to feel like a kid again. I want to play ball.
Well, see what you say? You said, I want to feel like a kid. Now, you have to say, what is stopping me? And you said something, you said your body.
Well, yeah.
What were you going to do about it?
Spend 5 minutes with Franco, the ageless wonder. And you realize that staying young is a matter of inches, specifically the 5 between your ears. After 30 years in the pros, he's a classic case of controlled aggression.
You're in the fighting stance. Like, you know, like you're gonna fight me. Throw an uppercut. Okay, see how this hands goes? Right. See how his hands go? See everything go from here? See this? See, if I'm gonna swing, look at the hands. See how the hand is?
So it's like the uppercut.
Exactly.
Julio Franco came up with the Phillies in 82, and he quickly established himself as a polished infielder with a good bat. Then he moved to the Indians, where he displayed his power and speed. But his best years were with the Rangers, where he won a batting title in 1991.
I'm watching the ball.
Right.
Then I'm on the step. And
Julio wants my hands and body to remain behind the ball.
See how I'm staying?
Yeah.
See, I'm not bringing the bat like this.
Right.
No. I'm staying back here, okay? And I'm going, boom. If you set your mind to do something, you will do it. It doesn't matter what he says, what she says, or what my friend says. It doesn't matter what you say.
Yeah.
It's what I believe.
After 13 seasons in the big leagues, Franco had developed a bum knee and was advised to hang it up. But Julio disagreed with that assessment, and for the next four seasons plied his trade in Japan, Korea, and Mexico, where, in 2001, his .438 batting average prompted the Atlanta Braves to sign him at 42. Talk about living an impossible dream.
The only thing that a man can do is fly. We don't have any wings. Other than that, we okay.
Watch when it happens, when I put the shoulder.
Franco expects to play into his 50s, setting records for longevity.
Right? Oh, man.
The oldest major leaguer to hit a home run, the oldest to steal a base. Talking with Julio, I felt the years falling off me.
Yeah, perfect.
This?
Okay, I may not look like a kid, but I'm sure as hell beginning to feel like one again.
I thought you were still hanging.
I'm sorry.
You should just do that.
Okay, I won't.
Coming up on Seventh Inning Stretch.
I always wanted to play real baseball stadium.
And later,
baseball's nothing but common sense. See the ball, hit the ball, catch the ball, throw the ball to first.
It's been over 25 years since I started playing guitar with a band called the Smithereens. What powered us then, and still does to this day, is the energy of our fans. And in all the ballparks I visited during my unlikely journey, the love remains. As strong as ever. It seemed everybody wore a jersey with someone else's name on it.
And they want to announce it to the world. I like this guy. And when you're that guy, and you look up in the stands, and you see your name worn by somebody else, and they're cheering you on, that goes to the heart. Most bands would dream to have fans love them with the passion that, let's say, a Yankee fan loves the Yankees. If a band has fans that have passion, then you've really got something important. They name their kids after your songs. They do all, you know, that's what it's about.
This will be on A&E called Gene Simmons Family Jewels. Oh.
Those are on buses and billboards all over town.
Gene Simmons has built a music and marketing empire. Not bad for an Israeli immigrant who came to Brooklyn at the age of 8.
One of the first things I heard besides hello is, what are you, stupid? Can't you speak English? Baseball for me was synonymous with America. Baseball was the place where poor kids, strictly based on their own talent, could gain access to the American dream. Was what you did when you got out of school. You played stickball, and you didn't have to know a lot of stuff. You just survived by your own wits. I always wanted to play in a real baseball stadium. Eventually, KISS started playing baseball stadiums. Anaheim Stadium, Atlanta Stadium, and, you know, it says, you've arrived in America. I mean, it was, for me, very emotional.
And we have NASCAR and the National Hot Rod Association cars.
This is nutty. Come on, you'd have to be crazy to. Oh, yeah, that's right. My work continues, this time in North Carolina with the Mudcats. I've got a lot of catching up to do. 35 years, in fact. The mountain seems to get a little taller every day. I'll need to train not only my body, but also my mind. Attitude and focus are key.
Now, Pat, start to think the phrase, see the ball, over and over. And when that locks in your mind, you're gonna see that go yes. And each day you do this, that yes is gonna be a stronger yes. Put it down, and that's the way you're gonna lock it in your mind. Every day, just do that.
After a set in L.A., I put down my axe and I went 90 miles south to San Diego, where a master hitter lives.
The marks that you're making on this thing, they're all over the place. And so you've gone from...
A future Hall of Famer is set to straighten out my swing.
It's a chronicle of my progress, because I started there,
okay,
and then I'm up here now.
There you, well, see, when you're hitting a baseball bat with a wood bat, you get that much room.
That's the sweet spot,
that's
right?
That's it.
In 20 seasons, Tony Gwynn collected over 3,000 hits and 8 batting titles. But that's only part of his legacy. After he retired, he returned to his alma mater, San Diego State, as head baseball coach. He works in a stadium that bears his name. How cool is that?
This is what it looks like. You're here, and when you start, you're taking all your weight.
It was Don Mattingly that got me focusing on my weight shift. But Tony felt I was taking it too far.
Pat, listen to me, okay? When you take your hands back, why does the weight have to shift? You don't have to get all the way back. Just a subtle shift. Your weight is here. Mm-hmm. Your subtle shift to the back and take your hands back, and you'd be in position. Take your hands back and set your foot down. You see how he did that? He hit 400 last year. If he does this for real, he did 500. There you go. That right there is his best swing of the day right there. There you go. Get out of here before we mess it up. That's excellent.
Last August, I slipped through the front lines into enemy territory. Fenway Park.
That's been my gangster phase.
Get it back, dude.
I left my Yankee hat back in Jersey. I might be crazy, but I'm not stupid.
You ready to go? I can't teach you back.
It was a trip I had to make. After all, you can't do a show about rock and roll and baseball without visiting with David Wells. A guy who successfully mixed a rock and roll attitude with great pitching talent.
All rock and rollers want to do what we do.
Yeah.
And we want to do what they do.
Should I go all the way to the mound, or should I just go halfway and underhanded?
While Fenway feels smaller than it looks on TV, the green monster looks even bigger and more imposing than ever.
You ready to see me scare the shit out of him? Ready?
All right,
he's
checking it.
The Fenway public address system plays heavy metal whenever David steps up to the mound.
I'm gonna screw him up. I'm gonna throw him a curveball.
He began his career as a mediocre reliever, then developed into one of the best starting pitchers of his era. He did it with the kind of feistiness of a lead singer.
It took us
6 years just to get a record deal. You know what I mean? That's a long time without any success.
It took me 5 years to get to the big leagues.
There you go.
My album was in 87, my debut album.
Even that perfect game in 1998 was a source of controversy.
Ball of two strikes on Shane. Swing and a miss. And now it's 16 in a row.
He was fined $100,000 by the Yankees front office a few years later when in his book he said he had a hangover that morning. Later, Wells said he was misquoted. In his own book. Now that's rock and roll attitude. This old Yankees fan has a confession to make.
I can hit, I just gotta...
You gotta recognize the pitchers, and that's why...
I like David Wells even more now than when he wore pinstripes.
I was just trying to find your power slot.
After all, Wells, he gave me a shot at the Green Monster. Which, by the way, survived my visit.
It's all right, not too many people can do it.
Thanks, David.
You're very welcome. Good luck to you.
I'm back in New York to test David's theory about rockers that want to be baseball players.
How sweet!
You played minor league, right?
Semi-pro. There's only three things kept me out of the big leagues. I couldn't hit, run, or throw. I was going to play baseball in the summer, semi-pro, and I just played the local bars in the winter. And that was going to be my life. I was going to, you know, be a bar band. And then we got a chance to play with the Stones, and I begged for one gig with them. And then the next day, Bill Graham hired me for another gig. Then another one, and then another one. And then before I knew it, EMI Capital came around with a record deal. So I said, the Mets aren't after, or I'm asking you for a shot, it sure is not. Capital wants to sign you, so I figured this was gonna be my life.
I take it some of you people have heard this story before.
After he landed a recording contract, he produced a string of hits.
We're gonna hear it again.
As for baseball, he has a common sense cure for its ills.
When I become the commissioner of baseball, which I'm going to do when I retire from music, I'm going to be the next commissioner. First thing I'm going to do is get Pete Rose in the Hall of Fame. It's the first thing I'm going to do. You know what my second move is going to be? Everybody 65 or older gets in free. Everybody 12 and under gets in free. The team that finishes the worst or with the worst season, they have to sit out the next year.
These are all very common sense solutions to
baseball's
it.
Nothing but common sense. See the ball, hit the ball, catch the ball, throw the ball to first.
If only the game were really that simple. Baseball season is over. Fall is here. My preparation continues.
How's my form?
That's better.
This off-season conditioning reminds me of the pressure I felt all those years ago when I wrote our second album. The Smithereens debut had been a big hit, and the record company was eager to get us back in the studio. But we'd had years to come up with the songs for that first album, and I had just 5 weeks to write the tracks for the second. I locked myself in my apartment until the work was done. It was the only way. Now it feels like I'm doing the same thing.
Stretch it out and stretch it right back down.
I have the winter to prepare my mind and body for one more shot at my impossible dream. It's February in Jersey, but I might as well be in Fairbanks, Alaska. Despite the numbing cold, I have to get some swings in. I don't know what's crankier right now, me or this infernal batting machine. I could definitely use a little inspiration. I wonder what my dad would say. Must have been late 1985 when Dad called and asked me to return to Jersey. He said we needed to talk. It was 5 years since I'd formed the Smithereens. Yet for all the hard work, we had very little to show for it. True, we had a loyal following, but no record contract and no money in the bank. So my dad looked me straight in the eye and he said, "Son, you're 30 years old now, and frankly, people are beginning to talk." He told me it was time for me to give up this crazy dream and get back to work. It was an opening on one of the company trucks. I could start right away, picking up garbage. He was only looking out for me. And let's face it, it was good advice from his point of view. I was crying when I turned him down. 6 months later, my dad was sitting in the 10th row, and I was performing at Radio City Music Hall. All the magazines were calling us an overnight success, and the long night was over. We had made it. And although my dad never admitted he was wrong, I noticed that whenever I looked down at him from that stage, he was singing right along with me. He knew every word of every song.
To me, he achieved. I have two gold records hanging on my wall and a platinum, so I think he did pretty good.
The pitching machine has locked up in the big freeze. It needs the spring. And so does this old rocker. This is the final chapter of my saga.
DiNizio, Macy, Maxi, Mikoski, Wargo, Cage Group.
It begins at Cal Ripkin Stadium in Aberdeen, Maryland. The Ironbirds have been kind enough to let me work out with them. I seek advice from the Iron Man himself.
With us for the whole year?
Yeah.
The most monotonous part about being a good baseball player is the repetition in batting practice and repetition on ground balls.
Yeah.
You just have to get used to it.
I could not touch the guitar for 6 months, but I could pick it up after playing it for 40 years and it comes right back to me.
Well, since I retired, though, I haven't taken many ground balls, but I think I could do all right.
You gotta give me a couple pointers.
So I gotta get back in game shape on that quick again?
At least show me how to hold the bat without falling down.
All right.
So now you know how I got here at the Somerset Patriots ballpark, bat in hand. But you don't know why.
You know, you've been working real hard. I've been watching, you're gonna play tonight.
I know what you're thinking, but it's not so weird, really. I mean, all the guys have made me feel right at home.
You like this?
Love it.
Sparky told me he'd give me the nod when it's time. I'll be ready. I'm always ready.
Okay, Pat. Now's your chance. Don't let us down.
Everybody sing along with me on this.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the bar.
Okay, so my minor league dream fell slightly short. But if I didn't quite reach my destination, the trip was worth the effort. I agree, it was crazy to think that I could ever play minor league ball at my age. But hey, isn't that what dreams are made of? After all, each one of the folks that helped get me to this point are crazy in their own way. And they're living out their dreams.
Three strikes, you're out at the old ball game.
And the funny thing is, at the heart of baseball, what I was searching for all along was never further than the Little League field just down the block. It's there that I shared some of my enthusiasm and passion and knowledge that I gained over the last year with youngsters only a little younger than I feel. My advice, pick up a ball, glove, bat, head down to the sandlot. Before you know it, you'll be that kid again too. As for me, I'm off to get my driveway back.